And eventually you taught him that actually singing to the microphone, not the drumsticks.
In time, yeah.
He got it.
Singing drummer.
So let's talk a little bit about the book. It's very much, isn't it? I mean, it looks back right from the beginning of your life. And very much about your father, actually, isn't it?
Yeah, the whole thing started really. I found these, my grandfather's two books about an army doctor, my published, well-received, my father's book, unpublished manuscript. Mm-hmm. And I'm sitting there with two books, and my wife said to me, Angie, you know, there's some kind of legacy you should address. And so for me to be able to use my father's book in my book, like I do, and see his stories alongside mine, was a real achievement, actually.
He was in the Navy, Royal Navy, very successful in the Navy. Would he have preferred you to go into the Navy? I mean, and particularly, when you told him you were going to be in a rock band, it must have knocked him back a bit, I thought.
It's very hard to imagine what he must have seen in those days, you know, after a nice education. I'm going to be in a band, Dad, you know. But the funny thing was, the book's about that generational change. You know, in the 60s, until the 60s, young men wanted to become their fathers. Mm-hmm. Then come the 60s, anything but their fathers. So there's a big left turn for us, I think, in the UK, socially and stuff like that. And I think that the book's kind of covers that generational change.
Oh, what's really lovely about him, even though he had a completely different sort of career from yours in the Navy, is that he was very supportive, actually, wasn't he? He came to so many of your gigs and all.
Yeah, I mean, he was, you can't imagine what it must have been like, you know, in a band with long hair down to here, you know.
And he was a dowdy, sort of immaculately dressed man.
I used to meet him at his club in London, in St. James, the Royal Naval Club, you know, and he'd be in a three-piece suit, and I'd have long hair and flared velvet trousers and an Afghan coat, you know, and he, bless him, you know, he took me and chatted away and tried to give me advice and stuff.
What's interesting also is the first, as we said, the first sort of memoir of Genesis, the inside story. And what struck me was that to those of us who bought the records, it was all actually done on a shoestring.
Absolutely.
Wasn't it? I mean, you were traveling around in a van and sleeping here and there and then just kind of threw together the first
album. Well, what was nice in those days, you could have your apprenticeship. You could learn your craft, make two or three albums. Didn't cost very much, you know, and sort of learn slowly how to do it. Whereas now, it goes too fast. It's so high profile, you know, when you have a record out and on television, have to sort of succeed straight away.
Yeah. But you ended up, I mean, at one point you owed your record label hundreds of thousands of pounds.
I know.
But
luckily, what it was, had we stopped, the debt would have gone. It was just that if you'd make any money, you had to pay it back. But luckily, when Peter Gabriel left, I mean, we were well in debt. But luckily the drummer could sing, so it turned out well.
Yes, and sing he did, didn't he? Of course, Mike and the Mechanics, you wrote the most lovely song, which people are very affectionate about, The Living Years. The book is also called that as well. Let's just remind ourselves of the song.
I know that I'm a prisoner to all my father held so dear. I know that I'm a hostage to all his hopes and fears. I just wish I could have told him in the
not many sons will have not shed a tear listening to that, thinking about their fathers who've passed on. The lyrics sort of imply that there's a rift between fathers and sons, something not said. But was there ever really a rift between you and your dad?
To be honest, not really. I mean, I read it with B.A. Robertson, and it was his lyrical idea. Mm. And he lost his father, about the same time that I lost my father, and had new babies. So in a sense, really, the song applied to both of us and our lifestyles. I think his father had more problems with BA than my father, in a way, was supportive of me, I think. Mm. You know, but the trouble was, we didn't really talk in those days. You know, in the book, I covered the fact the last sort of 8 years when I was away on tour with Genesis, and it was going fantastically, and you know, you're in that bubble. We didn't really talk very much.
But would your father and would fathers in those days have wanted to talk, or wouldn't they have been a bit sort of embarrassed by the emotion?
They just couldn't find enough common ground, really, I think. Mm.
Yeah, has that changed, do you think? Has that changed with your son, for
example? Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think that left turn that we had has definitely now kind of gone away, really.
And that boy that we saw in the video there,
32.
He's 32 years old. Gosh, how time flies. It's amazing.
Oh, and tell us about school as well, because you say you're not that naughty at school, but you did
you
eventually...
You were a naughty boy at
school. You eventually did get,
I got thrown out of child house, yeah. But it was, as I was saying to you earlier, it was a different time, you know. It was old-fashioned school, bad rules, you know, in a sense.
Bad rules. I mean, your housemaster did ban you from from everything. He banned you from playing the guitar.
Probably why I did it, exactly, yeah.
At one point. But then, what, the funny thing was, I don't know what you, I can't remember what you got thrown out for, but you did go on little nighttime excursions up to London.
Up to the Marquee Club to see the Cream and other bands, yes.
Yeah. And then you went into Godalming when you weren't allowed to, all that sort of stuff.
It's the wildlife in those days.
Yeah. One thing I do want to touch on you with is Genesis, and a band divided into two parts, if you like. Something like the Rolling Stones when Brian Jones left, and Roxy Music when Brian Eno left, and Genesis is a band when Peter Gabriel was there and when he wasn't. And I was amazed that you had one big long phase, actually, with The Lamb Lies Down, where you all knew he was going to leave, and yet you managed to put a double album together.
Well, we were mid-album, and you sort of started to think maybe the time was going to change, you know. And the trouble, of course, that was 75. It's a long time ago, you know. The bulk of our career was actually with Phil singing, really. And then we sort of started the solo stuff and the Mike and Mechanic stuff later on in the 80s.
Mm. And what about Genesis now? Do you ever think you'll go back on tour with them again?
There's no plans at the moment. Phil wants to do some more work, I think, actually.
Right.
Could be for him. I mean, just back in musical again, which should be good.
So you wouldn't rule it out, though?
No, never. But at the moment, the last couple of years, I've been touring Mike and the Mechanics.
Yeah.
With Rutherford and Tim Howe, and it's fun, I really enjoy it.
And you're re-releasing some of the...
Yeah, absolutely. Music. I'm here selling my wares as a book, as a CD. I bring out a collection of our singles, actually. And when you put all the songs together on one CD, it's quite a nice... I'm quite proud of the body of work, some of the Mechanic songs. Some great songs.
Well, your body of work in the past 45 years is pretty amazing anyway, isn't it?
And they're remastered, are they?
Yeah, and it's a Living Years album. Oh, it's all going. Living Years album remastered. With live songs of Carrick and Paul Young, and there's a singles collection, which is
singles. We'll send you the bill for the advert later.
Absolutely, Mike, it's all there.
Thanks very much. Thank you,
Mike. Thank you. And Mike's book, The Living Years, is out on Thursday.
Let's get a last look at the weather. Here's Carol.
Good morning. It's a cold start to the day. Temperatures have fallen below freezing for some of us overnight.